We're live. It's the Snarky Sisters. It's the Sunday Songwriter Spotlight. And I'm Diana.
And I'm Lisa.
And our guest today is the incredible, fantastic Yvette Landry.
Woohoo! Yay! Woohoo!
It's the Sunday Songwriter Spotlight with the Snarky Sisters. Live at half past noon.
12:31.
Right here on our Facebook page. With our friends we will commune. Because we're Trotskyists.
Because we're communists.
Featuring the amazing Louisiana musician Yvette Landry. And some of her magical tunes.
She's a Louisiana lady. From the town called Lafayette. Her music is as spicy as a Cajun crab croquette. Makes me want to have shrimp and egg stew with a baguette.
Please welcome Yvette!
Hello!
Hi! Hey. That was fantastic.
Use that for free.
Oh, great, great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
We have to toast anytime. Our guest. Yay.
I've got a little red Yvette is my champagne toast.
And I just have an old Cajun screwdriver. Cheers.
Cheers. Cheers. Cheers. Clink, clink. To you. Clink.
Oh, no, I just ruined my computer screen. Whoop. Cheers.
It's cracked.
So, Yvette Landry, welcome. Do a short little bio here.
All right.
Louisiana Music Hall of Famer, Grammy nominated, singer-songwriter, multi-instrumentalist, interpreter, author, cultural ambassador, .. That's a lot of different hats for one person to wear. But you seem to be making it work. Yvette Landry has her own style. She fronts the Yvette Landry Band and Yvette Landry and the Jukes. And her debut award-winning album titled Should Have Known was released in 2010. The album was named Offbeat Magazine's Best Country Folk Album, and Landry was the Best Country Folk Artist. So cheers. That's really Yay. Wonderful. Yay. She's traveled the world, even touring Russia, serving as a cultural ambassador on behalf of the Library of Congress. Sounds like something Joe Jenks, our friend, did also as well. She has graced the stage at both the Library of Congress and John F. Kennedy Center of Performing Arts in Washington, D.C. So by day, Yvette is an educator, teaching ASL, American Sign Language, songwriting, bass, guitar, and accordion. Whew, that's a lot. I'm tired just thinking, wow, that's a lot. And by night, Yvette is a musician, singer, songwriter, and author who continues to tour worldwide, gracing the stage with greats such as Vince Gill and the Time Jumpers, Daryl Scott, Rhonda Vincent, and many more. Since her debut album in 2010, Yvette has released 4 more CDs and recorded on more than 30 records. That's a lot. That's great. Her first children's book, The Ghost Tree, was nominated for Louisiana's Young Reader's Choice Award. And more recently, her second book, Madame Grand Doit?
Doit. Madame Grand Doit.
Madame Grand Doit, along with The Ghost Tree, were formally accepted into the Library of Congress collection for children's literature. Sorry, I have to do this.
Yeah, oh, thank you.
That's freaking amazing. And her latest project, Taking the World by Storm, is twofold. The book, A Conversation with the Godfather of Swamp Pod, covers the lifespan of this living legend, Warren Storm, and the companion album produced by Yvette entitled A Regional Roots Journey with the Godfather of Swamp Pop includes guest John Fogerty and more. So she's a musician, she's an author, an educator. Just stay tuned for what she's got down the pike. Thank you and welcome, Yvette.
Welcome.
Woo-hoo.
Thank you. Man, it's really weird when I hear you read all that stuff. I'm like, who is that person?
It's y'all. You did it all.
Really crazy.
Impressive. And you're outside your house in Lafayette, right?
I'm actually right outside of Lafayette in a little town called Brobridge, Louisiana. And we're known as the crawfish capital of the world. And we have the world famous Brobridge Crawfish Festival every year. Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, what's the difference between a crawdad, a crawfish, and a crayfish?
Well, if you're from Louisiana, you say crawfish. And if you're from anywhere else, you say crawdad or crayfish. But it's the same thing. It's the same thing. We say it right. What can I say?
So what about the crawdad song? Should it not be the crawdad song?
Well, I mean, I don't know why they call it the crawdad song. But, you know, now that you're saying that, I want to say that that is the first song I actually sang when I was probably in the fourth grade for some kind of competition at school. I hadn't thought about it since then.
Yeah. You get a line, I get a pole. Huh?
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one. Yeah. So, but no, seriously, I think it's just a, you know, potato, potato kind of thing. We say crawfish over here. We don't really say crawdad or crayfish, but yeah, it's all good.
What's so special about the heads of a crawfish anyway?
Well, the heads of the crawfish is where the fat is. And the fat is like really rich and buttery. Some people will do like you say, and they will suck the heads. Other people will just kind of stick their finger in there and kind of yank it out. But if you're cooking crawfish, that's what you want, because that's, if you're cooking like an etouffee or a crawfish stew or something like that, that's where you get that good taste from. Yeah. Okay. So that's what's special about the heads.
Diana, wasn't there a big event you used to do with your band with a crawfish up in Baltimore?
There was, the Hungry for Music had a crawfish boil, and we used to play that. Yeah.
You know, when I come from an area in Louisiana called Acadiana, and it's an area where the exiled French people from Canada were sent to, or actually ended up at. And so we have our own little unique culture over here. And so when the Cajuns came down in 1776, they were starving. So they found these little mud bugs, so to speak, in the ditch, and that's kind of the food that they ate. And for the longest time, it was just known as trash food, you know, it was just nasty. But now they're like golden, like, and people will pay a lot of money to have them shipped up to Maine and Massachusetts and the West Coast, and there's crawfish festivals all over the country now. So, yeah.
And in Maine, lobster used to be trash fish too. You know?
Exactly.
And now it's the opposite. Well, let's go ahead and have you sing us a song.
Oh, then, all right.
Yeah.
Cool. I will sing you the first song I ever wrote in 2010. And I was not a songwriter at that time. I was playing bass guitar in a Cajun music band. But I met a young man from my area who had gone up to Nashville to become a songwriter. And I asked him, I said, man, how do you write a song? Because it's beyond me how somebody could, one, come up with lyrics and words, but then put a melody to it. I don't understand. And he looked at me and he said, well, I'll tell you. I said, all right, you know, and I'm ready to get this bit of information. And he goes, you just got to pay attention. And I remember thinking, what a jerk. Like, you just don't want to tell me how to write a song, you know? And so we were all camping one day in the woods up in northern part of Louisiana, I guess. And I was a middle school teacher at the time. And I started talking about, man, you know, kids today, they don't know what it's like, you know, to grow up like we grew up. You know, we used to go to our grandparents every Sunday and eat dinner together, and we climb trees and we go walking in the woods, and now these guys are all, you know, on their phones and playing computer games. And so I'm just going off on a rant like that, and he looks at me and he was just kind of smiling, he shakes his head and he goes, there's your song. And so I still thought he was a jerk, because I was like, you're not telling me how to write a song. But I came home after that weekend, and I picked up my guitar, and this little thing came out. It's called Where Memories Are Gold. TV took the place of campfires, and walking underneath the bright white stars. Walking in the woods, turned into smoke-filled bars. And nobody takes the time to write love letters anymore. Guess the way things used to be means more now than it did before. So close your eyes and take me to the place where the black water flows. Back to a place and time where my memories are gone. Well, nobody knows their neighbors, visits with the folks on Sunday night. Sitting at the table turned into drive-through signs. And sitting with the family telling tales just don't happen anymore. Guess the way things used to be means more now than it did before. So close your eyes and take me to the place where the black water flows. Back to a place and time where my memories are gone. Back to a place and time where my memories are gone.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Woo-hoo. Yes. So that's it. That's song number one.
Ha. So how old were you when you wrote that song, and what brought you to that place that you wanted to write songs?
Well, so let's see. I started this late in life. I bought a bass guitar at 40 years old. That's when I started playing music, at 40. I was going through a divorce. My dad was dying of cancer. Life was just kind of upside down. And I found myself driving around one Saturday, and I pulled into a parking lot of a music store. Couldn't tell you why to this day. And I walked in and I was like, I want a bass guitar. So I got a bass guitar, and I ended up playing Cajun music at Cajun music jams. And I'd been doing that from 2004 to 2010. And there were people in, I was in two Cajun bands at that time. One called the Lafayette Rhythm Devils. And the other one was an all girls band, which was the Grammy nominated band, Bonsoir Catin. And everyone in the band was singing and writing songs, and I was like, I think I want to learn how to sing, and I think maybe I could write a song. I don't know, but it didn't make sense to me. It just didn't make sense as to how somebody could do that, because I hadn't written a book. I hadn't written anything, you know, other than a check probably. And you know, like I said, like I met this songwriter guy, and he told me to pay attention. And I think when he said that, I think something clicked. And it's like after that light switch came on and I started paying attention, it's like the light switch came on and everything cleared up. And you were in trouble if you were around me during that first time, because when that channel opened up, whatever I was paying attention to, I was writing a song about. So if you did something goofy, or if you were standing by me, or if you pissed me off, there was going to be a song about it that was going to be written. So you needed to be careful when you're around me. But it was just something. It's like the channel opened up and the songs were gifts to me. I never really felt like I sat there and wrote a song. I felt like the song was given to me and I just wrote down what was given. And I remember my mom asking me, Well, what do? You write the lyrics first or do you write the tune first? And I sat down and I thought about it for a long time before I answered her. And I said, you know, it all comes together. Like it just, it comes. It's really difficult to explain that process because I know there are songwriters that go to work every day and they're lyricists and they write lyrics and then they give it to the, you know, to the other people who put music behind it and they collaborate and they do all this stuff. But mine was more of a, here you go, here's your song.
So once you started songwriting, how did you first like branch out to have other musicians play on stage with you? Were these people that you knew before, or people that once you became a songwriter, then you met them after the fact?
Okay, so I'll tell you, that's a great question. Thank you. So at the time, like I said, my dad had brain cancer, and I moved back to Brobridge from about 14 miles down the road in Lafayette. That was my big move, by the way. I moved 14 miles and then I came back. And they lived about a block away from me. And so these songs started coming, and I would go over to my dad's house and I would play the songs for him. And he would say, you need to make an album. You need to do that. And I said, Dad, no, you know, I'm not a songwriter. I'm just writing and I'm playing for you. You know, I don't know what I'm going to do with this. And he ended up, you know, passing away suddenly. And I remember thinking, oh shit, now I gotta make a CD, you know? So the musicians that I was playing with were Cajun musicians. But the songs that I was writing were more of a, like old school country kind of Americana kind of thing. So I knew of musicians in my area that I had never really played with, but I just knew of them. And so I just went to a couple of them one day and I said, hey, look, I have like, I don't know, I wrote 17 songs and I don't know if I'll write any more. So I want to put them all on one record. And can we go into the studio? Would you do that? And they said yes. So we met, I think, one day during the week, and I said, here's my songs, here's what I he like hear in my head. And we went into the studio that weekend and we put out that CD in a 2 days, maybe, like, you know, 2 6-hour days, and there it was. That was it, you know. And they were there. You want to put all those songs on there, but I kept thinking, well, if I only put 14 songs, and I have 3 songs that I didn't record, and I may never write another song, and then I won't have these 3 songs. So I ended up, yeah, buy my first one. It's a big bang for
All right,
the
yeah. So
buck.
what's the intersection with like New Orleans and Lafayette musicians? Do they a lot of musicians travel that 2 hours or whatever it is?
You know, back in the day, I'd say more so than, of course, now, you know, not too much anymore, but it's 2 unique different cultures between New Orleans and Acadiana. And you know, they have their old style of, you know, jazz and you know, the stuff that they play in the streets in New Orleans. And over here, you get more of the Cajun and Zydeco style. So there's not a whole lot of crossover, but as you know, being a musician, you don't just play in one band, you play in four, five, six, seven.
Oh, ask Diana, she plays in a thousand.
I traveled one time and somebody said, you know, in Louisiana, I swear you have like about 300 bands in your area, but you only have 30 musicians. That's about right.
So when you guys were doing sound, I missed part of a conversation. I heard you talking about the jazz festival with Diana. Was there something that you were talking about that you had participated or you do participate in that?
I do, you know, New Orleans Jazz Festival is one of the premier festivals in the world, you know. So to get to play at the New Orleans Jazz Festival, that's an honor in itself. And when I started playing music in 2004, it was in the summer of 2004. So I didn't play Jazz Fest that year, but the following year I got invited with my Cajun band as a bass player and played from 2004 till 2010 as a bass player in Cajun band at the New Orleans Jazz Fest. So, I mean, that in itself is incredible. Then in 2010, when my album came out, they asked me to play as Yvette Landry and go and sing my own songs. And since that time, I've played at the Jazz Fest up until last year when they had to, you know, postpone the festival. But so Yeah, when I speak those words, that's amazing to me that I've had a run of playing Jazz Fest that many years in a row. It's crazy. But the story I wanted to tell you as a songwriter playing at Jazz Fest, you start out on a small stage before you make your way to the big stages, right? And so I'm into like my second or third song of my original songs. And it was a song called Dead and Gone. And as I'm playing the song, I'm really nervous when I play in front of people. So a lot of times I'll close my eyes and I don't really look at the audience, you know. So I had my eyes closed and then I heard people singing. Like there was the whole front row, the two front rows, they were all singing my song and it threw me for a loop. So like cool. I froze. I opened my eyes and I almost stopped singing because I was thinking, what is happening? How do you, what? But it was such an amazing feeling to know that like you're singing my song, the song that I wrote. And I was like, how do you even know that? You know, it was, so that was incredible. Yeah. Gosh, we could do a whole show on just the incredible Jazz Fest stories that I have. But that was a really amazing moment as a musician, as a songwriter, and just as a human being to experience that right there. Wow. Yeah. That was good. Wow. That was cool.
And I love all the connections that musicians have. Like, you know, Diana was telling me how she found about your music. And I was like, oh yeah, it was a long convoluted story. And by the time we got to the end of it, I was like, there were a lot of musicians on the way.
Yeah, no, that's it. You got to go all the way to Michigan to get to Lafayette. You know what I'm saying? Like it's just, yeah, it's wild. But you know, that's what being a musician is all about. It's that family and it's those connections that you make. Cause it just seems like once you make that connection, no matter how small or how short it is, it's there for forever, for all eternity, you know?
Yeah,
it's a special bond for sure.
Speaking of how I found you, Barry Koffler's watching right now.
Oh, hi Barry. Hi. Thank you, Barry.
That first album is a great album, he says. I was calling it the chicken party that I had missed, and you called it by its right name, the foul ball.
Foul ball. Mm-hmm. And that's S-F-O-W-L.
Not the foul ball.
Not the baseball.
So how about another song?
Yeah. Well, I tell you what, I mentioned the Dead and Gone song, sure, that the people were singing at Jazz Fest. And this is a song that it probably is better with a full band, but I'll do it anyway. And it's a song that actually almost started a fight in a nursing home. And that's a true story. It's called Dead and Gone. Don't trust that man until he's dead and gone. Don't trust that man until he's dead and gone. 'Cause he'll lie to you and then he'll take you home. He'll call you early to get a bite to eat. He'll pay the check and then leave you in the street. I said, don't trust that man until he's dead and gone. 'Cause he'll lie to you and then he'll take you home. He'll buy you roses and candy too. He'll romance you then leave you feeling blue. I said, don't trust that man until he's dead and gone. 'Cause he'll lie to you and then he'll take you home. He'll buy you diamonds and say, I love you. But don't you know he's got another woman too? I said, don't trust that man until he's dead and gone. 'Cause he'll lie to you and then he'll take you home. Oh, listen up, ladies, I'm gonna tell you about it. You know, ladies, here's where I stand. I can live without that man. Oh, he's nice, and he'll treat you like a queen. But then you find out he's just low-down, dirty mean. And sometimes, you know, you gotta leave that man and take matters into your own hands. So I woke up this morning as quiet as a mouse. Put on my makeup and burned down his house. I said, don't trust that man until he's dead and gone. 'Cause he'll lie to you and then he'll take you home. Yeah, there you go. Some dead and gone right there.
Hey, that was great.
Oh, thank you.
Well, who won the fight?
Well, so there was this, when I first started, and this kind of goes back to the question that you asked, when I first started playing these songs, I didn't want to do it really out in public. And we have a nursing home here in Brobridge, and I thought, well, you know, that might be a good spot to just kind of try and get my feet wet into singing and playing guitar and doing this stuff. So I went to the nursing home, and I'd been playing like 30 minutes, and no one was paying attention to me. They were all sitting in the cafeteria. They had some that was praying the rosary, some that were playing bingo. Most of them were sleeping on the tables, you know. Well, I started this song, and the first line, you know, don't trust that man till he's dead and gone. There was this little old lady who had been sleeping on the table. And when I sang that line, she picked up her head and she said, you tell him, sister. You tell him, those no good men, I tell you what. I mean, she went off. And then in the back of the room, there was this old guy in a walker. And boy, he started walking with his walker and shaking his fist. And he was like, those women, the men might be bad, but let me tell you, those women, they bad too. And then they started going back and forth. And I was killing myself. I was like, oh my God, my first time in public. And I'm going to start a fight in a nursing home.
There's a riot going on.
Oh my God.
Right.
So I don't think she ever could move her wheelchair fast enough, and he couldn't walk fast enough before they sent him back to their rooms, I guess. I don't know.
You have to have like a written disclaimer before you play that song.
Before I play that one. Exactly.
Oh, gosh. That is really funny. So Diana and I both have a little experience with playing in senior sort of settings.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have some fun stories. It's a fun thing to do. We really like playing, you know, in the different
places. Oh, it's fantastic.
We've played.
Yeah. No, it's fantastic.
We won't play that song. We won't cover that one. We don't need to start any fights.
Well, you know, it's like I said, when I first started writing songs, I never planned on being a musician, and I never planned on being a songwriter. So the songs that were coming out, I guess, as a songwriter, you know, you pay attention to what's going on around you in your life at the time. And what was going on in my life was my father was passing away and I was going through a divorce. So a lot of the songs that came out, I guess you could call, were man-hating songs.
Or strong, empowered woman songs.
Strong, exactly. Empowerment songs. That's a good one too. So, you know, that's what came out, you know, there's a lot of sad songs, a lot of kind of funny songs about what I was feeling at the time and just what I was seeing around me, you know, because I wasn't the only one. You know, as you know, most women, most men, most everybody has something going on in their life at some time. And sooner or later, you'll notice it. Yeah.
So I found on YouTube your trio. You were at the Library of Congress performing a bunch of songs.
Yes.
Would you be okay if I went ahead and showed one of those
videos? Yeah, sure.
Okay. So it usually takes me a second to get it up. Talk amongst
while
yourselves.
While you're doing that, let's see. Rick Wheeler says, love the voice, lots of soul and conviction. Yeah, there's a lot of soul there. Tommy Wright's watching. Rick
Hi,
says
Tommy.
She doesn't look like she's reached 40 yet.
She doesn't.
Adele agrees.
Thank you.
And Rick says, I like her approach to songwriting. And Adele is watching. Hi, Adele. And thanks for the clarification, Yvette. Barry writes to you. I guess that's about the man-hating songs. I don't know. Luke Bourquet says, this girl is beautiful. Her husband's a lucky dude.
That's my husband.
going to guess.
I actually gave him my CDs before our first date and said, you might want to listen to these before we go out.
No, that's right. And yeah, I have a challenge where I'm doing a classical piece every day. I think today's going to be 108.
Yeah.
Piece every day. And I was thinking, you know, if I'm ever asked out on another date and the guy has not looked me up to see who I am and has not even seen one of those 108, like, forget it. Just.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And she's great. She's Diana, you are such a good classical guitarist. Oh, my gosh.
Yes, she is.
So we have this little piece. This is Yvette Landry Trio, the Cajun music in Louisiana. Honky tonk musician here. So here we go.
Who knew Cajun music could be so sweet, huh? Even if you don't understand the language, you understand the music. So, you know, the music world is really small. It doesn't matter what part of the world that you're in, you know somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody. And this next song, we're going to move into some of the songs that I've written since I've been playing music. And when I started writing songs just a few years back, it didn't come out as Cajun music. It came out as sort of a country style music, but danceable like Cajun music is. And I got the idea for this song from watching a documentary on Bela Fleck. You guys know who Bela Fleck is? Yeah. So he was in Africa tracing the roots of the banjo. And he was talking to a chief from one of the villages, and the chief said, I want to show you where we bury our elders. And he brought him out to a little place, and he said, this is where we lay our elders to rest, and we put them in a house with no windows. And I thought that was such a beautiful saying that I needed to write a song about it. So here's one of my songs. It's called I'd Love to Lay You Down, and it goes a little bit like this.
One, two, three.
Thank you. Lay you down in a house with no windows, about 6 feet under the ground, sounds good to me. You'll have a marble roof in your house with no windows, and I'll put a sign for all the world to see. Yes, I'll lay it down for all eternity. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's sort of like you know, the box that it came in, you know, that old, that song.
Dude, I was gonna so talk to you about that. It's like if there was one song I wish would have come out of me, it would have been that song.
Yeah,
that is the song. Exactly. I do that song every gig because I was like, man, that is so my song. And I didn't even hear about it till a few years back. And when I heard about it, I was just like, oh, that should have been me.
And made of pine.
Exactly.
Great song. Exactly. Great song. That was a great song.
Thank you.
Lots of comments, too. Carol Bossell, love Yvette Landry. Saw her numerous times at the Augusta Heritage Center in Elkins, West Virginia.
Yes.
And John Pfeiffer.
Yeah.
You what?
I taught there. Yeah. I taught over there for several years. Yeah, it's fun. It's great.
Cool. Do you ever do sign language and sing at the same time?
I have, actually. We were playing at a house concert in Dallas, Texas, and somebody asked me to do that. So I put my guitar down. I had my steel guitar player with me. So he played the steel guitar, and I sang, and I signed. And I've also done the national anthem. If you watch the end of that video, I don't think I sing it, no, but I have sung and signed the national anthem at the same time as well. So,
wow.
But I can't do all three. I can't do all three.
All right, well, that's a goal for you.
Yeah.
So Diana has a honky-tonk band called Honky Tonk Confidential, and I swear you two are soul sisters. I can see you both up there together. Yeah.
Let's make it happen.
Yeah.
That'd be fun.
So
now
when
I've
you
got box that it came in going through my head.
Oh, right.
Man, I know.
So you were up in D.C. for the Library of Congress performance.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So did you have time to be a tourist in town? Did you check out some of the monuments and things?
No, unfortunately, we did not have time. It was just kind of a whirlwind trip. And then we come back because at the time I was teaching and I was a middle school teacher. So I didn't have too much time to spare. I wasn't a full-time musician, so, you know.
So now you are a full-time musician. What have you been doing the past 375 days?
Watching my hair grow? No. it's been interesting as a musician. When the pandemic first hit, my husband and I tried to find some ways that we could help local musicians who were solely musicians, full-time musicians, because I still had a teaching gig on the side. So I still had a little bit of income coming in. So we did something that we called Back Porch Jams, and we got sponsors, and it was called a Java Jam, actually. And on Friday mornings, we'd have coffee, and we'd invite a guest to go live and do a show, and then we'd help, you know, promote them and then help pay them and everything like that. So we did that for a while. We did a few live shows here and there, virtual live shows. And then it was nothing for a while, and wrote a couple of songs here and there. And then over the last few months, things have opened up in Louisiana where you could play outdoors but not sing. And then it kind of went to play indoors, but couldn't sing. And then just within the last month or so, we can now play indoors and sing with some restrictions still. So it's picking up a little bit here and there.
So have you had to sing with a mask on for anything?
I have, and it's very difficult. It's
Diana
really
can
difficult.
Tell you. I have too. Yes.
Yeah.
It's like being in a diver's suit at the bottom of the ocean, and your air has been cut off.
Right. As a performer,
but you still have to be happy and sing.
Yeah. So, you know, they'll see it in your eyes, but then it's just very difficult to enunciate words when you have cloth in your mouth, and it's hard for the audience to hear. So, you know, we make do, but eventually I think it'll come back to where it was.
I'll be ready. I played behind a plexiglass screen the other day.
Yeah, they started with that here too. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you still have to wear the mask behind the screen?
No, not if you're behind the screen.
Mm-mm. Okay, well, good.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been a crazy and surreal year. So I think we told you, Diana and I were down in New Orleans in January 2020 before, you know, the COVID hit and everything. But then I just read an article about how they think that COVID hit New Orleans sometime early in February.
Yeah, Mardi Gras, I believe, was right. I think was the super spreader for New Orleans.
And then they think one person from Texas, I guess, was the person that brought it. And then, you know, that's what they think at this point. Yeah. So, a lot of us got sick after the Folk Alliance. And we were like, was that like, you know. I don't think it was, but it was a really bad flu. You know,
yeah, so. It was terrible.
Who knows?
But we love New Orleans. I've never been to Lafayette, so.
Oh, you need to come because it's a whole different experience.
Mardi Gras there is very special, isn't it?
It is, and it's different. It's not the, well, you have two Mardi Gras, actually. So you have your typical New Orleans Mardi Gras where you have the parade and, you know, you catch beads and things like that. But then you have the actually old school Mardi Gras, the country Mardi Gras that we call it, where people dress up in Mardi Gras costumes, which is a capuchon hat, which kind of mocks the royalty of the French kings and queens and royalty. And you go around from house to house begging for ingredients for a gumbo, playing music and dancing and doing all this stuff. And you walk for miles and miles and miles till you get all the ingredients. And then you go to somebody's house at the end and you make a great big gumbo and you have a great big Cajun jam and dance and a fado dole, as we call it. And that's our Cajun Mardi Gras. So.
Do you make gumbo? Are you a good gumbo maker?
I think I am a good gumbo maker. Yeah.
What do you put in it? What are the ingredients for yours?
Well, we can do, you know, like a chicken and sausage gumbo, where you start with a roux. Everything Cajun based over here starts with a roux, and then you put your onions and bell peppers and you cook that down, and then you add in your, you know, you fry your chicken separately, you cook your sausage separately, and then you kind of put everything together. And I'm not going to give away all my secrets, but you know. That's kind
ooh,
of.
Ooh, it sounds like you have a musical cookbook coming up soon.
Ooh, you know, we thought about
that's
that actually.
That's a good idea. So ooh, there are a couple more comments. Karen Collins says, "Hi, Yvette. Nice to see
Hi,
you."
Hi, Karen.
You know Karen?
I do know Karen. Karen's a great country singer.
She's fabulous.
She's awesome.
Yes.
She has a great show every Friday night. She's on the Lost Highway web streaming show. She's fabulous.
Yeah. It's been a while since I've seen Karen.
Someone named Luke Bourquet says, "Yvette is so humble." That's your husband. "There's actually a Hollywood film currently in development based on her life. Is that true?"
It is true.
It is
true. It is
true.
It is true. Yes.
What? Tell us.
Tell us about that.
Luke Bork. I can't believe you.
I'm sorry. It's Bork, not Bourquet.
That's okay. Like he's in the house and I'm on the porch, so I can't fuss at him.
Come on out, Luke. Come on out. Bring your banjo.
No, you know this. It's been such a the whole thing has been such a wild ride. We were actually in Nashville. I had just gone up to sing about a year and a half ago with Vince Gill and the Time Jumpers over at Third and Lindsay.
I love the Time Jumpers so
much. Oh, my God. Good. I mean, I wish we had more time so I could tell all these stories. But I can tell you, standing and singing with Vince Gill right on the side of you, and then you're singing and all of a sudden you hear this voice singing harmony with you and you realize it's Vince Gill. And
Gill.
Your knees just go weak, you know. But anyway, we had just done that, and then the following morning, my husband went down in the. We were staying in this little hotel. He went down to get some coffee and some food, and there was a couple of gentlemen at a table sitting there, and there was nobody else downstairs. So he could not that he was listening, but he could hear what they were saying because there was nobody else there. And he realized that the guy had something to do with Hollywood and movies but from what he was talking about. And he thought, man, wouldn't it be cool if I could get one of Yvette's songs in a movie? So he goes over to this guy and introduces himself and starts talking to him. And one thing leads to another. And before we know it, we find out that this gentleman is an attorney to all the huge stars. He's like one of the top attorneys in the industry. And he's like, you're coming to Sundance and you're going to perform at Sundance for this party, like Sundance Film Festival.
Yeah.
And we're like, we met you 5 minutes ago. What? What are you talking about? And so we just thought he was blowing smoke. And we got home and we had emails waiting, like, you're coming on this day. This is going to happen. This is going to happen. And so I went up to Sundance, and then one thing led to another. And my husband was like, I think I'm going to just pitch an idea for a movie. And so he pitched the idea for a movie about me and Warren Storm, which is a swamp pop, the godfather of swamp pop here in Louisiana. He's a 85-year-old musician, and I ended up writing a book about him, and we made a record with John Fogerty and, you know, a bunch of, and before you know it, we had a script, and then it's like one thing led to another, and then it looks like as of yesterday, we're probably going to, this movie's going to happen, and there's just going to be a movie.
Well, congratulations. That's awesome.
Congratulations. Really, seriously.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes. Keep us posted.
You want to play another song for us? Want to play a Swamp Poppy song for us?
You know, let's see if I don't know if I have a Swamp Poppy one that I wrote that I'm thinking of right now, but I'll do. You know what? I'm going to do this song right here. When I first started, there was a kind of a hostel in Lafayette called the Blue Moon Saloon, where it was the hot spot. You know, it's where all the cool bands played. It's where all the people went. And so, like, I'm trying to make this story short. So at the time, I was pretty much done with dudes, right? I was done with dating. I was done with life. I was done with everything. I just didn't want to do anything, right? So my friend, one of my bandmates, had gone to lunch one day with a bunch of her friends. And there were two women who were partners, and they were asking about me. And one of them was like, man, like, what's up with Yvette? You know, I never see her dating any guys, you know? And so her girlfriend, she looked at her and she elbowed her like that. And she said, bitch, that girl ain't gay. She just country. So they started laughing. And so my friend called me and she was telling me this story. She was like, man, this, you know. So, of course, you know, I was paying attention at the time. So from that came a song called The Blue Moon Girls. Let's see if I can sing this. I'm gonna drop this a half a thing. Well, she wears her hair pulled way up high, mini skirts up to her thighs, and high heels no damn way, you're just cowboy boots. She don't rock and roll, she plays George Jones, and a pickup truck is what she owns, and a white trash boys, yes, she's had a few. You can see her at the moon on a Saturday night, dancing and drinking by the neon sign, smoking cigarettes just to give it a whirl. She ain't gay, she just a country girl. She don't wear no makeup or dye her hair. She got tattoos everywhere. Yeah, the boys come out just to see her swing. Twirling around on the old dance floor, rocking a Porsche by the red front door. It's a high time at the old Blue Moon. You can see her at the moon on a Saturday night, dancing and drinking by the neon sign, smoking cigarettes just to give it a whirl. She ain't gay, she just a country girl. Down in the pit till the break of dawn, dollar slips all night long. She's a doom girl, and that's just her thing. She's a blue moon girl, and that's just her thing. Yow! Blue moon girl. Thank you.
Can you please ask whoever it is who's handing you out these songs to hand me out like one song, please?
Well, let me give you some advice. You just have to pay attention.
Thank you. Now this is where I like you to say.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you.
Exactly.
I think Karen was in a band, or is in a band, called Blue Moon Cowgirls.
Cowgirls.
I think that's what they call
it. Oh, okay. Themselves. Awesome.
Yeah, awesome. We have to get her to sing that song. That's definitely, yeah. That's
She's
great.
Heard a few. She's had a few.
So before, I just want to ask you a little bit about your trip to Russia. Can you tell us a little bit about that? I'm really intrigued.
Yes. So
she's a spy.
I'm a spy. Well, you know, we went in February and somebody said, wait, the government sent you there in February? Russia? Siberia? Really? You sure that was a good trip? But we went as part of the Library of Congress's effort to teach the people who live in Russia that Americans are not what they've been told, basically, for so many years, and vice versa for us, you know. So it was a cultural
exchange
to try and bridge the gap and connect better to the people. And it was really amazing because, you know, the cultures are so, so different. And the one venue that I remember the most was we were performing at a factory where they built tanks. And, you know, in Russia, you're not given an opportunity to say, well, I want to be this or I want to be that. They basically say, you're going to work in this factory and you're going to work 14-hour days. And then you're going to go listen to these Americans who are singing French music. And, you know, so we played, and when we play our music around here, people dance and they love it and they're, you know, they're into it. Yeah. And the people were sitting there after a 14-hour workday, not understanding us, not understanding the culture, nothing. And so we were getting absolutely nothing from them. And I could not wait until the gig was over. And there were two bands that were playing. There was a Cajun band and an Exotico kind of Creole band. And so I played bass with the Cajun band first, and we did our little 45-minute set. Then the Creole band got up there, and I was playing bass with them. And Jeffrey Broussard was the accordion player, and he said, I'm not stopping until somebody gets up and dances. And I'm thinking, we'll be here till next year because nobody's dancing over here. And some little girls from upstairs who were taking a dance class, a ballet class, heard the music, and they came down, and they were standing on the side of the stage. And they actually started dancing. And then somebody in the audience saw the little 13-year-old girls dancing. So they started dancing. And before you knew it, like within 10 minutes, the entire audience who had not smiled, who had not moved, who had not done anything, was up on their feet and they were dancing. And when the show finished, every last person in that audience stood in a line and thanked us and asked us for our autographs and was smiling. And it was kind of life-changing for me because I said, I don't know if we changed Russia's thought about the United States, but I know for the 300 people that were in that auditorium that night, the next time they think about Americans, that's what they're going to think about, not what they were told to think about it, you know. So so it was a wonderful experience, you know. We traveled all over.
So did you sing, was this band, were you singing in French only, or did you sing in English and in French?
Mostly in French, but there are a few, there's a couple of Cajun songs that are in English. So we would sing some in English, but the majority of it was in French.
Do Russian speakers, a lot of them still know French? I know back in the day they used to, but
not. And if they do know French, it's not the Cajun French. It's the quote proper French, you know.
So they knew nothing what nothing. You were saying. They were just nothing. Listening to the music.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, you got two of them. That's great.
We did. You know. So I knew in that moment that trip was worth doing. You know, even if it was for 300 people. But I think we touched a lot more than that. So.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I guess the
person is enough. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
And I think the girls gave them permission. Like seeing these other kids dancing gave them permission to get up.
That was it. Yeah. No, it was a moment. You just saw it. It was kind of like when the little switch flipped and I was able to write a song, something in their brains flipped, the switch flipped. And it was like, oh, I think I can have fun. I can enjoy this. You know, I have permission to do this. And they actually felt the music and started moving. Yeah, it was cool.
That's really nice.
I wanted to ask you about your guitar, because when I first saw it, I thought it might be a Gibson J45 or 040. And
it's,
tell us about it.
It's actually modeled off of a 53 Gibson Southern Jumbo that I had been playing since I started writing songs in 2009. And it was becoming, my Gibson was becoming like a Willie Nelson guitar. I was getting holes everywhere.
In that Library of Congress clip, you could see where that hole
was. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I went up to New York, actually. I was in upstate New York, and I was playing a gig with Jesse Leger and Darren Wallace. And Darren Wallace was playing fiddle, and I just knew him as a fiddle player. And I started talking to him because he asked me a question about my Gibson. And I said, yeah, man, I need to get a guitar, another guitar, because this one is, I mean, I'm beating this one up. And I said, I would love to have a guitar made, but I don't know anybody who makes guitars, and I certainly probably couldn't afford a guitar. And he said, well, I know somebody that makes guitars. Let's talk after the gig. So after the gig, he comes up to me. Well, come to find out, this guy has been building guitars for 50 years. For the last 30, he was at Ovation. You know, he worked at Taylor. He worked at all these places. And so he said, I'll build you a guitar. He said, I'm thinking about actually starting my own line. So he said, I'll build you a guitar. And I said, oh, man, that's fantastic. I said, well, but I don't know if I could, like, what's this going to cost? And he said, well, look, we'll just make an exchange. I'll build you a guitar, and then you'll just play it, and you'll tell everybody that Darren Wallace made your guitar. And there I am, Darren. You got it. And so, yeah, he took everything that I liked about my Gibson, and he, I don't know if you can see it right now, but he took my signature and he inlaid it right here. So nice. It's a signature guitar. It's an Yvette Landry signature guitar. Wow. And I tell you, it, you know, sometimes when you buy a new guitar, how you have to play it so that the wood will actually warm up, you know, and just sound like just like you want it. This guitar from the get-go just sounded like somebody had been playing it for 30 years. It's just, it's amazing. Yeah, I really love it. So that's my guitar story. That's my Darren Wallace guitar story. Check him out. I think he's in Nashville now, working for Gibson, actually. Yeah, and he still does some stuff on the side. So check him out.
Nice. Darren Wallace, it's a beautiful guitar.
Yeah, it is. She's a beaut. She's a beaut.
Yeah.
Oh. There you go.
We have time for one more, if you have time for one more for us.
I do. Let's see. If Luke Bork is still listening, maybe he could suggest a song that he'd like for me to play, because I have so many to choose from right here.
Take a look. In the meantime, Carol Bossell says, so happy to hear about the movie and can't wait till it comes to fruition. Lafayette is one of this country's cultural treasures, and Yvette is part of the rich fabric of that community. So many happy memories there, including at the Blue Moon Saloon.
Aw, yeah. That's so sweet. Thank you.
Is Lafayette where there's one town that does it's a horse race?
That's in Mamou. Well, there's a bunch of them, but Mamou, and that's the old school Mardi Gras. Yeah, Mamou will do the riders. They'll do a separate all men, and then they'll do a separate all women, and they get on their horses before daybreak, and they, where some people will walk and play music, these guys are on horses, and they have a music wagon, and they go around from house to house begging for the gumbo ingredients. And so my husband actually made it out to the porch right now.
Okay. With his accordion.
I really like the one you wrote a little over a year ago, because I opposed that.
Oh, you want me to do that one? Wow, okay. So
what is that?
Well, I can't believe he asked me to do that one. So this is like my most recent song that I wrote. And Bo Thomas, the guy that on the fiddle that you saw in the clip, his dad, Bo is an incredible fiddle player, but he's also the class clown. I mean, he's just a hoot. He keeps me in stitches all the time. And when I met his dad, I realized, oh, now I know why you're the class clown. I mean, you get it from your dad. So we were playing at a gig one day, and his dad, who is 84 maybe, comes up to me, so I give him a great big hug, and I was like, oh, Mr. Carroll, how you doing? And he hugs me all slow, and he whispers in my ear, and he goes, darling, I'd marry you tomorrow for a honeymoon tonight. And I said, I was killing myself laughing, and I said, you know what? I'm going to write a song about that. So it took me about a year and a half before I wrote it. But I hope I can remember the words. Let's see if I can do it.
Bottle's almost empty. The bar is almost closed. Another lonely night again, that's all I've ever known. As you walk by across the floor, I shine in neon lights. Oh, I'd marry you tomorrow for a honeymoon tonight. These smoke-filled bars that I call home is just a place to go. Swinging doors and dance hall floors and wine and music flow. The only one I've ever loved walked in all dressed in white. Oh, I'd marry you tomorrow for a honeymoon tonight. Storms of love roll over this lonely heart of mine. Light another cigarette and bring on the wine. It's 2 a.m. the last song sung, I leave alone again. And arm in arm you walk away, it seems I never win. One day, baby, you walk by and see I'm Mrs. Right. Oh, I'd marry you tomorrow for a honeymoon tonight. Yes, I'd marry you tomorrow for a honeymoon tonight.
Thank you.
That is great.
Thank you very much.
That's a hook. A little perfect country song.
There you go, right?
Yep. Some housekeeping, everybody who's watching, please share. Is there a Venmo underneath us too, Lisa?
Above us, yes.
Above us, okay. Woo-hoo. And put some money in the tip jar because musicians need it. And share again and again. And we're coming to a close. When we say goodbye, Yvette, stay on with us because
Yes, what a delight. Thank you, Yvette Landry. You are a fabulous singer-songwriter.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, this is so much fun.
Please promise that you'll come again.
Yes.
Sunday would be great. No.
So thanks to everybody watching. And check out YvetteLandry.com.
Yes, YvetteLandry.com.
Bye. Thank you.